Hello, this is Matt Dean with A-Plus College Ready. Our lesson for today is on evolution and Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. One of the most important things for your students to know about evolution is the definition. Evolution is a change in the allele frequency of a population over time. It's very crucial that your students realize that individuals can't evolve. The population evolves. It's also important for them to understand the definition of an allele. They need to know that an allele is a version of a gene. For example, for flower color, there might be alleles for red, maybe for white. So again, evolution is a change in the allele frequency of a population over time. There's several requirements that must be in place for evolution to happen. One of those is that the population has to have genetic variability. This genetic variability may come from mutations, it can come from immigration, processes like meiosis, and also sexual reproduction. Those also contribute to genetic variation. Number two, more offspring are produced than can survive. This is where natural selection takes place. Charles Darwin thought that the mechanism of evolution, the process that drives it, was natural selection. Some of the offspring are killed, either due to limited resources, food, water, etc., predation, disease, and so forth. Number three, some of the organisms are better adapted than others. And the most important thing is that these adaptations have to be genetic adaptations. Number four, there must be differential reproductive rates due to the adaptive characteristics of some of the members. Those with the better adapted traits maybe live longer, but more importantly, they have more offspring. And because they have more offspring, the allele frequency of their alleles increases. That's evolution. Now, you oftentimes hear of evolution described as the survival of the fittest. And a lot of people incorrectly think that means the strong survive. Fitness in an evolutionary context means the ability to reproduce. Those that are best able to reproduce are the most fit. You might also hear this referred to as fecundity. Again, fitness and fecundity refer to the ability to reproduce. Hardy and Weinberg were two scientists who looked at the idea of genetic equilibrium. Genetic equilibrium is an idea or a situation, a theoretical situation, when allele frequencies in the population are not changing. Today, we also refer to genetic equilibrium as Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. Again, Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium is essentially a theoretical condition when evolution is not happening. Probably doesn't completely exist in the real world. According to Hardy and Weinberg, there are five requirements that must be in place for a population to enter into and remain in genetic equilibrium. Those five requirements are, number one, there can be no mutations in the population. In particular, we're talking about here germ cell mutations, because germ cells are the cells that end up going through meiosis and becoming gametes. The genes in those cells are the only ones that are passed on. Somatic cell mutations don't matter so much here. Somatic cells are just body cells, and the genes in those cells are not passed on to the offspring. Number two, there can be no immigration, either coming into the population or exiting the population. Sometimes we might refer to that as gene flow. When immigration happens, new alleles might be introduced into the population, or some of those alleles, unique alleles, might leave the population. Three, the population must be really large so that we don't get genetic drift. Genetic drift is an unpredicted change in allele frequency due to chance. It almost always occurs in a small and usually an isolated population. Four, there must be no natural selection. And five, there must be no sexual selection. Mating must be random. Mates aren't chosen based on some characteristic in this case. So again, Hardy and Weinberg equilibrium is a theoretical situation in which evolution is not happening, in which allele frequencies are not changing. So essentially, by defining this theoretical case, Hardy and Weinberg were able to define the things that cause evolution. If you look at the negative of the five requirements for Hardy-Weinberg evolution, you're really looking at the five things that might contribute to causing evolution. Mutations can cause evolution. Immigration can cause evolution. Genetic drift can cause evolution. Natural selection can cause evolution. And non-random mating or sexual selection can also contribute to evolution. Now you can see at the bottom left of your screen, down here, a section off the AP Biology formula sheet. These are the Hardy-Weinberg equations. Hardy and Weinberg developed a system for using these equations for calculating allele frequencies. In these equations, P represents the frequency of the dominant allele in the population. Q represents the frequency of the recessive allele in the population. And notice that those two frequencies must add together to be one. We might think of it in terms of 100%. When we're using these equations, we want to work in decimal. So if you have a percentage, you want to convert that percentage to decimal and use decimal in these equations. The top Hardy-Weinberg equation deals with genotype frequencies. Remember, genotypes are the actual gene combinations an organism possesses. So P squared in this top equation, P squared represents the frequency of homozygous dominant individuals, individuals who have two copies of the dominant allele. 2PQ represents organisms that are heterozygous, organisms that have one dominant and one recessive allele for a particular condition. And finally, Q squared represents individuals that are homozygous and recessive, individuals that have two copies of the recessive allele for the condition that we happen to be looking for. All right, so what we're going to try to do in the rest of this video is to look at some example problems. We're going to try to look at pretty much every possible situation that AP folks might throw at you in terms of Hardy-Weinberg problems. So the first one's a very simple one. It says, in humans, brown eyes are dominant over blue eyes. And that's an oversimplification, but let's go with it for the problem. In a population of 1,000 individuals, 750 have brown eyes. Assume the population is in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. Part A, what are the frequencies of the dominant and recessive alleles? Part B, how many individuals would you expect to be heterozygous? And part C, what is the expected frequency of each possible genotype? So, what they gave us in this problem is that we had 750 individuals with brown eyes. So 750 with brown eyes. They told us we had 1,000 individuals. So if 750 had brown, that means that 250 have blue. Now the thing that we really have to look at here, and what you typically want to find in a Hardy-Weinberg problem first, when possible, is the percentage or the frequency of homozygous dominant individuals. Let me say that again, homozygous recessive individuals. Because notice in this equation, P squared and 2PQ individuals, it's very hard to tell those guys apart. By appearance. So again, we had 750 that were brown. Individuals that are P squared and 2PQ, they both have a dominant allele, which means they're both brown. Whereas Q squared individuals, they have two blue alleles. That's why they're blue. So in this case, we have 250 individuals with blue eyes out of a total of 1,000 individuals. That's our frequency of homozygous recessive individuals, blue-eyed individuals. So let's divide that out, 250 divided by 1,000, and that gives us 0.25. That is Q squared. That is our frequency of individuals that are homozygous recessive. Well, the next thing that we want to do is to go ahead and just do what the math says. Let's take the square root of Q squared. So if we go 0.25 and we take the square root of 0.25. Well, the square root of q squared is q. And the square root of 0.25 is 0.5. So that gives us q. Q is the frequency of the recessive allele. And if we look back at our problem, that's one of the first things that it asks us to find. Part A says, what is the frequency of the dominant and the recessive allele? Q is the frequency of the recessive allele. If we look back at this equation right here, we also find that P plus Q equals 1. Remember that P is the frequency of the dominant allele. So we already know the recessive allele is 0.5. P and Q together have to add up to be 1. So if Q is 0.5, P also has to equal 0.5. So our answers for part A, frequency of the dominant allele, P, 0.5. Frequency of the recessive allele, Q, also 0.5. Now if we look to part B, how many individuals would you expect to be heterozygous? So remember, in our top Hardy-Weinberg equation, this one up top, 2PQ, those are the individuals that are heterozygous. So again, the 2PQ individuals are the heterozygotes. 2PQ. So to calculate the frequency of heterozygous individuals, we're going to just do what the math says. We're going to say 2 times P times Q. So 2 times P, which we just found to be 0.5, times Q, which we also found to be 0.5. We multiply those together, 2 times 0.5 times 0.5, and that gives us 0.5. Now that 0.5 is the frequency of heterozygous individuals. 50% of this population is expected to be heterozygous. The question here, though, didn't ask us for the frequency or the percentage of heterozygotes. It asked us for how many heterozygous individuals we expected. So we expect 50% of a total population size of 1,000. So we're going to take 0.50 times 1,000, and that tells us that we're expecting 500 heterozygous individuals. Right. Part C, the last one, wants to know the expected frequency of each possible genotype. Remember that our top equation, this one up here, is the genotype equation. So we're looking for the frequency of homozygous dominant, the frequency of heterozygous, and the frequency of homozygous recessive individuals. We've already found two of those. We found up here that the frequency of homozygous recessive individuals, Q squared, was 0.25. So let's write that down. We also, here in the middle section, found that the frequency of heterozygous individuals, 2PQ, was 0.50. All right, what we have left is the frequency of homozygous dominant individuals, P squared. To find that, we just simply need to square P. Remember, we found that P, the frequency of the dominant allele, is 0.5. So we need to square 0.5. Squared is 0.25. So our answer to part C is the frequency of homozygous dominant individuals, P squared, 0.25. The frequency of heterozygous individuals, 2PQ, is 0.50. And the frequency of homozygous recessive individuals, Q squared, is 0.25. All right, Hardy-Weinberg problem set 2 gives us a different look. In the first problem, we were given either a frequency of phenotypes or genotypes. In problem set 2, we're given information here about alleles instead of about phenotypes or genotypes. So let's look at the problem. Out of a population of 60 people in a small town in Kentucky, one person has blue skin and autosomal recessive trait. And by the way, that's a real thing. Google blue people of Kentucky and read about it. You'll find it fascinating. Three people in the population are carriers for the trait. Assume the population is in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. Part A, we want to know how many total alleles, blue and normal, are in the gene pool for this trait. Part B, what are the allelic frequencies for this trait? Part C, what are the genotypic frequencies for this trait? And Part D, if the population is in genetic equilibrium and the original population produces 140 children, how many of these children will be carriers for blue skin? So, if we move on now, let's first of all try to find the answer to Part A. How many total alleles are in the population? Our problem told us that there were 60 total people. In general, each person has two alleles per trait. So we have two alleles. These people have two alleles each for skin color. And again, this is an oversimplification. There are 60 total people. So 2 times 60. We have a total of 120 alleles in our gene pool. That's our answer for Part A. That's it. You'll get this kind of problem a lot. Two alleles per person, per trait, times the total number of people or individuals. 120 total alleles. For Part B, they're asking us for the allelic frequencies. That is asking us to find P, the frequency of the dominant allele, and Q, the frequency of the recessive allele. So to do that, we know there are 120 total alleles. We were told in our problem that one person has blue skin. That's autosomal recessive. To exhibit an autosomal recessive trait, you have to be homozygous recessive for that trait. So that person with blue skin has two blue recessive alleles. The problem also told us there were three people who were carriers. Each one of those people has one recessive allele each, one recessive blue allele each. So that gives us two from the affected person, one each from the three carriers. That gives us five total blue alleles. This fraction of 5 out of 120 is equal to the frequency of our recessive allele, Q. We go ahead and divide that out, 5 out of 120, that gives us the decimal of 0.042. That's Q. We want to work in decimal when possible. So remember that P plus Q has to equal 1. So if Q is 0.042, P has to equal 1 minus 0.042, which means that P is equal to 0.958. So we've now answered Part B. The frequency of our dominant allele is 0.958. That means 95.8% of all the alleles for this trait in this population are dominant. Q is 0.042. That means about 4.2% of the alleles for this trait are recessive blue alleles in this particular population. So now let's move on to Part C. Part C wanted to know the genotypic frequencies for the trait. Remember, this top equation, top left, this is the genotype frequency equation. So they want us to find the frequency for homozygous dominant P square, heterozygous 2PQ, and homozygous recessive Q square. To do that, we just follow the math. To find the frequency of homozygous dominant, we just square P. P is 0.958. We need to square 0.958. And when we do that, we get 0.918. So that means about 91.8% of all the individuals are expected to be homozygous dominant, not blue, for this trait. For the frequency of heterozygotes, which in this case would be carriers for blue skin, we want to do 2PQ, so 2 times our frequency of the dominant allele, P, 0.958, times the frequency of our recessive allele, 0.042, So again, to find the frequency of heterozygotes,
2PQ, 2 times 0.958 times 0.042, we end up there with a frequency of heterozygous individuals to be, again, 2PQ equals to 0.08. So we're expecting about 8% of this population to be heterozygous or carriers for blue skin. And then finally, Q square, or the frequency of homozygous recessive individuals, we just want to square Q, so 0.042 squared. And when we do that, we get about 0.002. So we're saying about 0.2% of the individuals are expected to actually have blue skin, to be homozygous recessive for it. So our answers on part C, the frequency of homozygous individuals, homozygous dominant individuals, 0.918. The frequency of heterozygous individuals, 0.08. And the frequency of homozygous recessive individuals, which would be blue-skinned individuals, 0.002. All right, the last thing that we want to do is part D. And it says if the population is in genetic equilibrium and the original population produces 140 children, how many of these children will be carriers for blue skin? Two important things to remember there. Number one, if the population is in genetic equilibrium, that means that P and Q aren't changing from generation to generation. If P and Q aren't changing from generation to generation, that also means these genotype frequencies aren't changing from generation to generation. So to find the number of carriers for blue skin, we need to take the heterozygous frequency, 2PQ. These are the individuals that have one dominant, not blue allele, and one recessive blue allele. They're carriers for blue skin. We need to multiply that, 0.08, the frequency of having blue skin, times the total number of individuals in the population. Now, in this case, they told us that the next generation had 140 children. So we're going to take the frequency of carriers times the total number of offspring, multiply those together, and that gives us 11.2 individuals that are expected to have blue skin. Now, we know we can't have 0.2 of a person, but go ahead, write down the whole number. The AP question will typically tell you what decimal place to round your answers to. So pay attention to that. But we're expecting about 11.2 blue skin carriers. They won't actually have blue skin. They will be carriers for the blue skin allele. All right, here's problem three. In a given population of mice, brown hair, big B, is dominant to blonde hair, little b. Within the population of mice, there are 125 brown-haired mice out of a population of 300. Assume the population is in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. A, what are the frequencies of the dominant and recessive alleles? That's P and Q. B, what is the predicted frequency of heterozygous mice? C, the predicted frequency of homozygous brown mice. And D, how many mice are heterozygous? So let's take a look and see if we can't work this problem out. So the first question wants us to find the frequency of dominant and recessive alleles. The problem told us that there were 125 mice that were brown. We'll just use BR. There were 300 total mice. So if there are 125 that are brown, that should tell us there's also 175 that are blonde. Those have to add up to be 300. Remember, whenever possible, we want to find the frequency of homozygous recessive individuals. That's Q squared. If we can find Q squared, we can find all the other variables. In this case, Q squared is going to be represented by the blonde mice, because to be blonde, since it's a recessive trait, you have to be homozygous for that condition. So we're going to take 175 out of 300, and that fraction equals Q square, our frequency of individuals who have two blonde alleles. They're homozygous recessive for blonde. So if we divide out that fraction, 175 divided by 300, let's go ahead and put that in decimal form, That gives us 0.583. Now, the first thing we're trying to find here are the frequencies of the dominant and recessive alleles. So to find the frequency of the recessive allele Q, we need to take the square root of Q squared. So if we take the square root of 0.583, when we do that, we get Q equals 0.764. So that's the frequency of the recessive allele. We also know that P plus Q equals 1 from our top left equation there. So if Q is 0.764, P must equal 1 minus 0.764. So P is equal to 0.236. So we've now answered part A. We have the frequency of the dominant allele, 0.236, and the frequency of the recessive allele, 0.764. Now part B asks us the predicted frequency of heterozygous mice. Remember that in this top equation, heterozygotes are represented by 2PQ. So we're simply going to do what the math tells us to do. We're going to take 2 times P, which we just found to be 0.236, times Q, which we just found to be 0.764. And now we multiply that out. 2 times 0.236 times 0.746, and we end up with 0.352. That's our frequency of heterozygous individuals. We're saying that about 35.2% of the individuals in this population should be heterozygous. Part C asks us for the frequency of homozygous brown mice. Now remember that brown is dominant. So homozygous brown mice are going to be homozygous dominant, or P squared. So again, we're going to do what the math tells us to do. We're going to take P, which we found to be 0.236. And we're simply going to square that. 0.236 squared gives us 0.056. So we're saying about 5.6% of this population should be homozygous dominant for brown. All right, that leaves us with only part D. And in this case, we want to know how many mice are expected to be heterozygous. Here, we found the expected frequency of heterozygous mice. But what we want to find now is the number of mice. To do that, we're going to take the frequency, 0.352, and we're going to multiply it by the size of our population, which in this case we had 300 total mice. So 0.352, the frequency of heterozygotes, times 300, the total population size, that results in a total expected number of heterozygous mice of 105.6. All right. Let's move on to the next problem. This problem, like problem 2, gives us information about alleles instead of about genotypes or phenotypes. So we have to approach working this problem in a little different way than we did problems 1 and 3. Let's look at the problem first. In a given population of 200 insects, there exist 121 alleles for the recessive trait of purple exoskeleton color. Assume the population is in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. Part A. What are the frequencies of the dominant and recessive alleles, P and Q? Part B, what is the expected number of insects with purple exoskeletons? And part C, give the three genotypic frequencies for this population. All right, so first of all, we're given that there's a total population of 200 insects. Just like we did in problem number 2, we need to remember that each individual typically has two alleles for each trait. So we're going to take our total number of insects, 200. We're going to multiply that by two alleles per insect. That's going to tell us that for this trait, there's about 400 total alleles in the gene pool. Now the stem of the question told us that out of that 400,
About 121 of those, out of our total of 400, were recessive purple alleles. That should tell us, or that should represent for us, Q. Because remember that Q is the frequency of the recessive allele. We have 121 recessive alleles out of a total of 400. So let's divide that out, put it in decimal form. So 121 divided by 400 gives us, for Q, 0.303. So we now have a frequency of a recessive allele. Now again, go back to this equation over here, P plus Q equals 1. To find P, we're simply going to go 1 minus Q. So if we go 1 minus 0.303, that gives us a frequency of the dominant allele P to be 0.697. So we've now answered part A. 69.7% of the alleles are dominant alleles, and 30.3% are recessive alleles. Part B wanted to know what is the expected number of insects with purple exoskeletons. Remember, the purple is recessive, so the only way to exhibit a recessive phenotype is to be homozygous recessive. And in our top left equation, homozygous recessive individuals are represented as Q squared. These are going to be the only purple insects. So we need to do what the math says. Take Q and square Q. So in this case, that's going to be 0.303 squared. And when we square our 0.303, we end up with a frequency of homozygous recessive individuals of 0.092. Now, some people would stop and probably write that down as the answer. This question doesn't ask for the frequency of purple exoskeleton insects. It asks for the number of them. So to find the number, we need to take the frequency, 0.092, and we need to multiply that by the total size of our population, which in this case, the stem of the problem told us was 200. So 0.092 times 200, we end up with an expected number of purple of insects with purple exoskeletons to be about 18.4. So that's our answer to part B. Final thing we wanted to find were the genotypic frequencies. Remember that this equation up here is our genotype equation. We've already answered part of this equation. We're trying to find the frequency of homozygous dominant individuals, heterozygous individuals, and homozygous recessive individuals. Right here, we found the frequency of homozygous recessive individuals, Q squared. So Q squared came out to be 0.092. All right, again, Q squared, our frequency of homozygous recessive individuals, 0.092. All right, now let's find the frequency of heterozygotes, 2PQ. So to find that, we're simply going to multiply 2 times P, which was 0.697, times Q, which was 0.303. When we do that, 2 times 0.697 times 0.303, we end up with an expected frequency of heterozygous individuals to be 0.422. And then finally, we need to find the frequency of homozygous dominant individuals. Those are P squared. So we need to take P, 0.697, and simply square it. And when we do that, we end up with 0.486. So our answer for part C, our frequency of homozygous dominant individuals, 0.486. Our frequency of heterozygous individuals, 0.422, that's 2PQ, and our frequency of homozygous recessive individuals, 0.092. Now, one wrinkle they might throw at you, instead of asking for genotypic frequencies, they might ask for phenotypic frequencies. What you've got to realize is that in a problem like this,
even though P-squared individuals and 2PQ individuals have different genotypes, since they both have a dominant allele, their phenotypes look the same. So to calculate the phenotypic frequency, you would add together 0.422 and 0.486. So let's see, that would give you 80. That would give you 0.980. Those individuals all look the same. So they're not going to have purple exoskeleton color. Let's say the other color was green. So we're saying about 90.8% of this population would have green exoskeleton colors, while 0.092 would have purple exoskeleton colors. So the phenotypic frequencies would be 0.908 green and 0.092 purple.
All right, we've got two more problems I want us to look at. Problem number 5 also gives us a look at alleles instead of genotypes or phenotypes. It says, after graduation, you and 19 of your closest friends, so 20 total people, 10 males, 10 females, charter a plane to go on a round-the-world tour. Unfortunately, you crash on a deserted island, no one finds you, and you start a new population totally isolated from the rest of the world. So you're stranded there for years. It's like a Gilligan's Island type thing. Two of your friends, Carrie, are heterozygous for the recessive cystic fibrosis allele. So none of your friends have cystic fibrosis, but two of them, probably unknown to them, are carrying this dangerous recessive allele. Assume that the frequency of this allele does not change as the population grows. So your population is in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. A, what's the frequency of the recessive cystic fibrosis allele? B, what's the frequency of the dominant allele? And C, in future generations, what is the expected frequency of individuals affected with cystic fibrosis? So the first thing that we want to do is to try to calculate the frequency of the recessive allele. Remember, there were 20 total people. 20 total people crashed with you on the plane. For this particular trait, each person has two alleles. So we're going to say 20 people times two alleles per person. That gives us a total of 40 alleles in our gene pool. Out of that 40 alleles, two people were carriers for cystic fibrosis. That means that they had one cystic fibrosis allele apiece. Everybody else was homozygous and dominant normal. So there were only two recessive alleles out of 40 total alleles in our population. That fraction represents Q, the frequency of our recessive allele. If we divide that out, we get a frequency of the recessive allele to be 0.05. That's the frequency of our recessive allele. That's part A. Part B, we're looking for the frequency of the normal dominant allele. Well, don't forget that P plus Q has to be 1. So if Q is 0.05, P has to be 0.95. So we're saying that 95% of the alleles in this population are normal and dominant and not for cystic fibrosis, whereas about 5% of the alleles are recessive cystic fibrosis alleles, alleles that are dangerous. Part C asks us, in future generations, what's the expected frequency of individuals affected with cystic fibrosis? An important point to remember here is that this population is in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, which means that the allele frequencies don't change from generation to generation. So since the allele frequencies don't change from generation to generation, P, when you crashed, was 0.95, Q, when you crashed, was 0.05, those frequencies will remain constant from generation to generation to generation. Now we're trying to find the frequency of individuals affected with cystic fibrosis, individuals that actually have the disorder. The only way to have a recessive trait is to be homozygous recessive for that trait. So the only affected individuals will be Q squared individuals, individuals that are homozygous recessive. So let's calculate the frequency of homozygous recessive individuals. To do that, we're simply going to do what the math says to do. We're going to take Q,
0.05, and we're going to square it. So when we square 0.05, we end up with 0.0025, or about 0.25% of our population is expected to actually have cystic fibrosis in generations to come. So even though those two alleles were in our original population, the actual occurrence of cystic fibrosis in future generations is going to be very, very, very low. Only about 0.25%.
All right, here's our final Hardy-Weinberg problem for this video. In a population of frogs, the allele for brown skin is dominant to the allele for green skin. A drought leads to selection against green-skinned frogs. Let's think about that for a second. Let's say the environment was nice and green. So green-skinned frogs before the drought would have had an advantage because they would blend in with the green surroundings. Now the drought happens, things start to turn brown, and green-skinned frogs are more visible to predators. Brown-skinned frogs in drought conditions now have an advantage. So over time, the green-skinned frogs start getting picked off by predators. The brown-skinned frogs are camouflaged. When the drought ends, 33% of the remaining frogs have green skin. If the population enters and remains in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium immediately upon the end of the drought, what will the frequency of the green skin allele be after three additional generations? That's part A. Part B, what is the frequency of the brown skin allele after three additional generations? C, if there are 350 frogs in the population, how many of them are expected to be heterozygous? And D, how many of the 350 frogs are expected to be homozygous and dominant? So the first thing that we want to look at, when this drought is over, 33% of the population is still green. Green's recessive. The only way to have a recessive phenotype is to be homozygous recessive. That should tell us all, I hope, that if you're green and you're a frog, you're Q squared. You're homozygous recessive for being green. So Q squared is equal to 33%, 0.33. Once we have Q squared, if we want to find the frequency of the recessive allele, Q, we need to take the square root of Q squared. So if we take the square root of 0.33, we end up with 0.574. That's our frequency of our recessive allele, Q. That's our answer to the first problem. Now, part B wants to find the frequency of the dominant allele. Well, you have to remember that P plus Q equals 1. We already said that Q is 0.574, so P is 1 minus 0.574. So P is 0.426. Now, it asks, what is P after three additional generations? That doesn't really matter in this problem, because the stem of the problem told us that the population is now in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. That tells us that the frequencies don't change from generation to generation. They could have asked us about one generation, three generations, or 7,000 generations. As long as the population is in Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, these frequencies don't change. So 0.574 is our Q, our frequency of our recessive allele, and 0.426 is our P, our frequency of the dominant allele. Part C wanted to know, if there are 350 frogs in the population, how many are expected to be heterozygous? Remember that heterozygotes are represented as 2PQ. So we're going to go 2 times P, 0.426, times Q, 0.574, multiply that out, and we get an expected frequency of heterozygotes of 0.489. Now, a lot of people would probably stop and write that down as the answer. This question doesn't ask for the frequency of heterozygotes, it asks for the number of heterozygotes. So to get that, we need to take the frequency, 0.489, we need to multiply that by the population size, which in this case is 350. And when we do the math there, we expect there to be about 171.2 heterozygous frogs. Those frogs are still going to be brown because brown is dominant, but they're carrying a green allele. Our final part of this problem, D, asks us to find, out of the 350 frogs, how many are homozygous dominant. So those are going to be homozygous dominant brown frogs. Remember that in our Hardy-Weinberg equation, homozygous dominant individuals are p squared. So we're going to take p, 0.426. We're going to square it. And when we do, we end up with a frequency of homozygous dominant individuals of 0.181. Now again, that's not where you stop. That's the frequency of homozygous dominant individuals. We need to multiply that frequency, 0.181, times our total population size of 350. And once we do the math on there, 0.181 times 350, that tells us we're expecting about 63.4 of these frogs to be homozygous, dominant, and brown.